masterclass. We're so glad that you're here. Carrie and I came together. Carrie, can you believe it's been like a whole year if you're listening?
I am here. I know.
And so we created the Growth Collaborative really as a way to talk about some of the most important values that Carrie and I have. And so we created this monthly masterclass really to focus on our four core values, which were wealth building and financial mastery, health and wellness, how to grow yourself personally and professionally, because Carrie and I both are strong believers that our business grows in direct proportion to how much you grow as an individual. And then, of course, because we're at eXp, we also want to talk about strategic client acquisition. And so today we have the fabulous Denny Faircloth joining us. Denny is a husband, a father, and a follower of Jesus. He is a lifelong entrepreneur, having developed direct sales organizations for over 40,000 people across the United States. He has created multiple six-figure leveraged passive residual income. That is a mouthful to say. Before he turned 30 years old, you guys, he is a mentor to thousands of realtors, investors, and entrepreneurs all over the nation. He is a podcaster. He's a content creator, a networker, a real estate team leader, and an investor and coach. He is partnered with Peter Pasternak from A&E's hit TV show, Flip This House. If you guys were watching A&E, gosh, Denny, it must have been like back in the mid-2000s. Flip This House was such a huge hit. I think it's still a huge hit. And so yeah, he's partnered.
I call him the OG because he was the first 2 million views an episode. And it's the show that spawned the 50 other versions of it.
Yes. So it was such a huge deal. I remember actually watching that. And I don't want to date you or anyone else on this call, but I remember watching it with my dad when I was a lot younger. So that really, I remember just like sitting back and watching that and thinking, this is so cool, Dad. Like you should do this. Denny is also a partner and a co-host of Real Estate Connections. This is a community of over 20,000 real estate professionals in Atlanta, Georgia, where Denny is based. He is a YouTube creator of Living in Atlanta, Georgia, and he is a licensed realtor and a team leader here at eXp. So Denny, without further ado, thank you so much for joining us. We're so excited to talk about events and the strategy and how we can grow our business and have fun at the same time. So thank you so much for joining us. I'm going to let you and Carrie take over from here.
Awesome. And just a side note, Denny and I met actually not in the real estate space, but more in the coaching space when I had the coaching company. Denny was one of my best coaches there, and just really got to know him, and just as a human being, really, really enjoyed our friendship and conversations, and always felt really good when I would introduce him to somebody that he would coach, because I knew he'd bring great value in a whole bunch of ways, not only in their business, but in their life. He's got a great family. He's faith-based. He's just a great guy. And we're going to learn a lot of good things from him today. So I'm excited. And Haley, thanks again for putting this together as you always do. It's amazing. And Denny, I want you to talk. I know today we're going to talk a little bit about networking, your best practices, how you've been so successful through it, how people should be taking this opportunity in this upcoming, you know, changing market to continue to do so, not only for production, but for agent attraction, both. But I also want you, if you don't mind, at some point to touch a little bit on your event in Atlanta, because we have some people here who already have some events going and who want to take it to the next level. And so maybe just a little bit about that conversation to plant the seed, and we'll have you back in eXp Family Tree to talk more about that at a later date as well. So I'm going to let you take it away from here. Of course, if there's any questions, you guys unmute, don't be shy. Denny would love to hear from you. You can also chat in the chat box, and I'll monitor and see if there's questions as we're live on Workplace in eXp Family Tree as well. So hi to those of you that are watching there.
Awesome. Thanks, Carrie. And just for interest of like time's sake, how long does this normally run?
Usually runs for an hour. So we've got about 50 minutes.
Awesome. Well, that is more than enough time. I just experimented with this virtual background. I just got a link card. Do y'all know what link is? L-I-N-Q.
Yeah.
It's like a digital business card. And I saw, you know, I was getting it for my networking events. Obviously that's the topic today, but I ditched paper business cards a long time ago. People are like, do you have a card? I'm like, no. They're like, but how are you a realtor? I'm like, well, I'm just not a good one. That's like, sorry, I don't carry cards. But I got Link recently, and I've been experimenting with all the ways that you can use it in live events. And then I saw this virtual background thing. And I was like, oh, that's really cool. People can just scan their screen, and then they can, you know, take them to wherever I want them to go. They can see my profile, get into all that. And so I will say it's a little bit distracting for me, though. So maybe I'll kill it. And I'll bring it back at the end. If any of you want to scan it and y'all want to get in touch with me, then feel free to do so. All right, choose virtual background. Let's go with none. Okay, there we go. Awesome. So as Carrie mentioned and Haley so eloquently introduced, I do a lot of things in real estate world. Me and authority go together like oil and water. So, you know, I've never had a job and I've never had a boss. I did when I was a teenager, but I got fired all the time because I didn't like being told what to do. And so a long time in financial services and then direct sales before I met my partner, Peter Pasternak. As Haley mentioned, 2005, 6, and 7, he was the lead character of A&E's Flip This House with millions of viewers an episode. The guy on the show with him was Brian. And during the crash of 08, in Georgia, they required you to get a general contractor's license in order to pull permits. And so Brian went and did that. And Peter was running around to all these networking events, trying to connect with real estate professionals. Most of the events absolutely sucked. And if they were any good, then maybe there was like one person in real estate. And so seeing a need, he went around to all the team leaders and brokers that he could find and said, hey, we're thinking about creating this real estate specific networking event. And everyone said, that's stupid. It'll never work. Literally, I think one of our dear friends, Kevin Palmer, who started Palmer House Properties, 3,000 agents or so, just sold to HomeSmart a few months ago for a boatload of money. But he was in the business for about, you know, as a broker for about 15 years. This is 12 years ago. So he was kind of just getting started, had a couple hundred agents. He said, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard of. It'll never work. So here we are. I met Peter and Brian right about that time. And like many of you, I had seen them flipping houses on TV. I was living in a neighborhood where that was going on. I really wanted to do it. I met Peter on Facebook. We became kind of fast friends and got together for coffee, instantly hit it off. And in 2010, started a networking event specifically to meet real estate professionals to build a general contracting company. I wanted you to understand where I was coming from and what our perspective was 12 years ago. Fast forward to today, we have over 20,000 members. Hundreds of real estate professionals come to our event every single month. It is tonight, so that's what I'll be doing later. And if you are an inspector, appraiser, property manager, lender, closing attorney, contractor, investor, realtor, team leader, broker owner, everybody from the industry comes together. There is no topic. There's no speaker. There's no, you know, other value other than the relationships that you're there to build. And so people get together, they have drinks, they shake hands, kiss babies, have conversations. And that business was the only thing that we did in order to get business for the general contracting company. And we did millions upon millions upon millions of dollars every single year in GC work just from the referrals we got from that group. And so today I want to talk to you specifically about how you as a realtor can build your business specifically on events. Doesn't have to be a real estate networking event, events period. This could be a business event, a personal event, a party, anything. And how you, the process that you go through in order to be effective and to get the best results. The second conversation I want to have with you when Carrie has me back is how you can do what we did and you can create an event. We created the event to get referrals for a general contracting company. Fast forward to today, that event pays us multiple six figures just for the networking event. And so not only did it generate millions, tens of millions of dollars in renovation and contract work for our general contracting company, it became a multiple six figure additional revenue stream for that business. The expenses for throwing that party are zero. Like it's an all profit business. And so that's the second conversation that Carrie wants me to come back and have with you. But for today, we're in the perfect time of year. You're going to be going to parties, throwing parties. And I want to encourage you, go to your industry events, go to real estate events, go to business events, go to Christmas parties, go to Thanksgiving dinners, you know, all of those. And so I think a lot of people, they hear like, we should go to an event, and networking is a good way to, you know, build your business, but there's no playbook. Like there's no like how to do it. So maybe you've been to an event and you've met this person. They're walking around the whole room and they're just throwing up on anyone that they talk to. They interrupt conversations and they pass out cards, right? Do you ever send them business? No, doesn't work. Maybe you've been the person that goes to the event and you're kind of introverted and you're just like, you don't know what to say or who to say it to. So you look around, you're like, well, I need to get drunk for this. So you find yourself over to the bar, you're like, a drink. And then you stand there for a few more minutes. You're like, another drink. And then finally you get up enough courage to have a conversation with one or two people. And, you know, they're not really relevant to your business. That was our frustration, is we wanted to meet real estate people. So talking to like a dentist wasn't really doing us any good. And so how do you figure out who to talk to? How do you figure out what conversations to have? How do you leave knowing that you've made the most out of your time there? And that's what I want to share with you today. So all that being said, Carrie, I have a PowerPoint.
Yeah.
The only reason I need it is to keep me on track. It's not going to have any visual value for anyone else, but, can I share that? Let me see.
Yes, you should have access to.
All right. The whole thing.
There we go.
Here. Yeah. And then you can just tell me, does that work?
Perfect.
All right. So we talked about this. I'm a Jesus follower. That just means that, you know, I'm really bad at life. And when I look to him for guidance, then I do better than I normally would. Married to this beautiful gal here, Ashley, who, you know, I always say that ladies, no offense, y'all, just hold on for 1 second. Guys, have you ever, like, you know, you've been in an argument with your wife, or she's like come home with something that without consulting you, or, you know, maybe she's just in general, she's made a really poor decision and you're thinking like, that woman's so stupid. Why doesn't she make better decisions? I just want to remind you guys, you're one of them. So I don't know why she chose me, but she did. And these are our crazy kiddos, Cooper, Lila, Lincoln, and Hank. This was about a year ago. So they're all 9, 7, 6, and 4 at the moment. And as mentioned, investor, connector, realtor, team leader, coach, those are all the things that I do. I love this definition of networking. It is the action or process of interacting with others to exchange information. Now, here's what I want to ask. Out of that, really quick, if anyone is up to it, like what word sticks out to you?
Action.
What were those? Come on.
Exchange information.
Okay. Anybody else?
I said action.
Action. Anybody else? Here's the one word that sticks out to me that most people miss. I don't know that anyone's ever said it. Process. Everyone just wings it. They go to an event and they're just like, oh, what do I do? And if that is your approach, those are the results you're going to get.
So can I just speak up for just 1 second? I was going to say process, but then I was like, oh, there's no other admins on this call, so they're just going to think I'm a nerd. I'm going to sit back and say nothing.
Well, you would have been the one person I would have pegged to pick that word. So that does not surprise me. I wish you would have said it. You would have gotten the first ever right answer to that question. Of course, this is, you know, it's a definition, but I don't think anyone ever thinks of process when they think of networking. they think of like the events or sales or getting and exchanging information. So what do I consider value-driven networking? This is just my little, these are the bullet points we're going to hit. Connection, interest, trust, questions, deposits, reciprocity, and the journey itself. And so what is, where can you connect? We talked about it. You can go to business events or network, you know, just networking events of any social or business related. This works, what I'm going to share with you works in both settings. It does not have to be real estate. Obviously, there are reasons as a realtor that you should be engaging with people in your industry, but you also want to do business and build relationships outside of the industry. So this is any event, could even be family parties, holiday parties, could be church. I volunteer on.
Hey, good afternoon.
I volunteer at the on the guest services team at our church, and I've used these same concepts, the same process that I'm going to share with you. And so, you know, you go do life, you go do the things you love doing, and then you do this while you're doing those things. And this could be online or offline. Take everything that I share with you now, and this applies to your online relationships too. So many people, they get on the internet and they start saying and doing things that they would never do in person, which is completely stupid. Networking online is just like networking offline. And for me, it all comes down to building relationships through adding value. And so this is not the shotgun approach. This is not the more the merrier. It is not how many cards you can hand out. It's not how many times you can give your pitch. Those are the ways that, unfortunately, some people do that naturally. Some people have been taught that. None of that works. Less is actually more. I want you to say less, literally say less, shut your mouth more, to less people. And that will ultimately get you better results. Curiosity is probably the number one character or approach that you can have to winning friends and influencing people.
That's right.
If you're trying to defend your position, you're fighting, right? If you're both trying to talk, you're fighting. I learned this from my pastor of our church. I go to North Point, and if those of you are familiar with Andy Stanley, I get the privilege of seeing him every single week. His father, Charles Stanley, was like a celebrity pastor and Baptist. Andy is a community church, Jesus follower kind of a guy. And so I get a lot of inspiration from him. And he talked about, he was doing a sermon on marriages. And he talked about if you and your spouse, and this could be any relationship, but if you and your spouse are both bringing all of your baggage and handing it to the other person, like, there's expectations that they don't even know, so they can't meet. If you're both doing a tug of war as to making sure that, you know, if you're a balancing act of who's serving who more and who loves who more and who does more and who's responsible for more, this could be in your business partnerships too. If you're always tugging, well, then you're always afraid to kind of let go, because in tug of war, if you stop pulling, you lose, right? But here's the thing. When you put down the rope, when you stop tugging, when you stop selling, when you stop trying to push yourself on other people, people are drawn to you. So instead of overcoming objections, if you will ask more questions, if you'll be curious about people, curious about responses, curious about their life, well, then you will be more interesting. So it's better to be interested in others than trying to be interesting. And you've probably, had this interaction with other people. You've met someone, and maybe later you were telling your spouse or telling your business partner or telling your friend, I met this gal Carrie and she was so amazing and interesting and all. And then they started asking you questions about her and you're like, you don't know anything about them because they spent an hour asking you about you. Like, that's people's, that's their favorite thing to talk about. So if you'll just shut up, stop talking, start asking, well, then people will gladly tell you everything you need to know. And they'll leave thinking that you were the most interesting man in the world because you asked the most questions. And then you simply sort through all the people that you're talking to. If you get into a conversation quickly, I realize that, you know, you're looking for real estate professionals and you're talking to a dentist, you just politely move on, right? But if you engage someone, the goal is to just pique their interest, right? So if you're in the event, or if I've been, put your feelings about Donald Trump aside. If he is a very successful real estate person, let's just leave it at that. If you saw him on the streets of New York and you had the best real estate deal that he had ever seen in his entire life, and you knew it was a home run, would you tell him all the details standing there on the sidewalk? Would he give you enough time to explain, to give you the pitch? No, he would be like, set an appointment. We'll come talk about it. So in the event is not the opportunity to say everything you need to say, right? Really, the opportunity is to just pique their interest. That's what you want to do. And so you'll say something like this. You'll talk to them for a couple of minutes, ask them some good question. And then you'll say, hey, it's really, really loud in here. Or this is really not the time or the place. Or I'm trying to watch my kid's soccer game. Or, you know, we've got a job to do if you're at a volunteer event. What doesn't matter. You're going to make up an excuse that's really true and say, hey, it's really loud in here and this is not really the time or place, but I'm going to give you a call, or I'm going to shoot you a text, or I'm going to send you an email. Depends on who you're talking to, right? Are they 50? Are they 30? Are they 20? Like, what? I'm going to DM you or whatever to snap. I don't know, but you're going to contact them the way they want to be contacted. I'm going to shoot you a text tomorrow and set up a time so we can see if we can help each other out. And so what do they hear when you say that?
They're going to help me out.
Yeah, that's exactly what they hear. You got ding, 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 you got it right. You're helping them. Like, you're going to solve their problem. They don't even care about you. They just care about them. Now, you tell me who's going to return your text or set up a call. Someone that you walked around handing out cards and throwing up your sales pitch on, or someone that you asked questions, you uncovered a need, and you offered to help. Like, yes, right? I just got a new puppy. If you had found out that I had a new puppy and I found out that you were, not a professional, but that you really love dogs and that you had trained a number of dogs and that you had the best dogs in the world and that your dogs all grow up to be, you know, happy, healthy, well-adjusted adults, and that you had this super secret formula for training puppies, I'd be buying you dinner. Like, tell me, please. Right? So they hear that there's something in it from you, but I do want you to understand this. This is a little bit of a sidebar. Trust, this is your first opportunity. Trust is being built one way or another at all times with all people, especially if you have young kids like I do. If you say you're going to do something and you do it, and then you say you're going to do something and you do it, and you say you're going to do something and you do it, people start to trust that you are going to do what you say you're going to do. And if you say that you're going to do something and you don't, and then you say that you're going to do something and you don't, and you say that you're going to do something and you don't, people are going to start trusting that when you say you're going to do something, you don't. And so if it's Friday, and like me, you know that your Saturday is going to be filled with youth sports and kids and distraction and Sunday church and volunteering or Sabbath. If you know that, like, you got a slammed weekend and it's Friday, you're meeting this, you're not going to text them tomorrow. Like, if you say tomorrow, make it tomorrow. If you say Monday, make it Monday. Just like, whatever you say, you do. And then this is an opportunity to build trust. And so again, everyone's topic is right there, themselves. And so you send them a text, you're going to meet for coffee, you're going to meet for lunch, whatever, you do what you say you're going to do. You send them that text and you're like, hey, let's meet Tuesday for coffee, or let's meet Monday for lunch, or whatever. And you get together. Number one problem that people do is now they just transition from setting appointment to throwing up. You got the appointment. This could be with a potential client. This could be with agent attraction. This could be any reason that you're meeting someone, and you bring your agenda with you. You bring, like, the thing that you want out of this relationship, and you impose that on the relationship. And here's the thing. I've met people that I thought were going to be clients that, you know, poured into me in some other way. Personally, I've met people that I thought was going to be a personal relationship and they ended up being a professional referral source. Like it's never happens the way that I think that I'm controlling it, you know, because I'm not the one in control as much as I want to believe that I am. So my point is, like, you have to be open, right? Don't get there and start recruiting. Don't get there and start selling. You get there and you just do what you did before and you keep the spotlight on them. And so their friends, their family, their occupation, you know, recreation, things they, hobbies, passions, things they love, their motivation, their dreams, their goals. Like that's where you start the conversation. And listen, we're not going to be there for 2 hours, but you know, build some rapport. And then you ask these same three questions. What I want you to understand about having a plan. When you know you're going to ask three things, you can actively listen without thinking about what it is that you're going to say. Because most people are listening and what they're thinking is, as soon as they shut up, I got to have something to say. You don't. All you got to do is listen intently and you will remember their wife's name or their kids' passions or their anniversary or their birthday or whatever happens to come out. You will remember identifying their problems or their challenges or things that you can help with, right? So you ask them these questions. You start, you know, after you build some rapport, you just say, hey, listen, you know, what's your goal in your business? If you're meeting with a lender, you're meeting with another agent and you're developing a referral relationship, or you're meeting another business owner, and it could be a dentist or a doctor or a lawyer, it could be whatever, depends on how you met them, right? Hey, what's your goal for the next year? If it's personal, you know, you might say, hey, what's your focus for the next year? If they've got kids, you know, you might, if someone said, hey, Denny, you know, with four little kids, you know, 9 to 4 years old, like you got a solid 15 years or more of this. Like if you look up from now, I'm 44, you're 60, they're all finally grown and gone. Like what would success as a parent look like to you? Oh my God. Are you kidding? First, no one's ever asked me that. So I would find that a pretty compelling question. And second, like it would maybe get me thinking about things that I hadn't thought about, but I would be endeared. I would be attracted to this person who just asked me this question about my, so, you know, you get them thinking about, hey, a year from now, 5 years from now, like what does success look like in whatever it is that just came out in this conversation? Could be personally or professionally. The follow-up question, they say, oh, okay. If they ask me that, I'd say, well, you know, for me, if 15 years from now, I look up and my kids are all not addicted to drugs or alcohol, if they are independent and have developed critical thinking skills and can think for themselves, then I feel like they'll probably figure it all out. Like that's my job. Independent, critical thinking, healthy, physically, mentally, emotional. Okay, great. Well, a natural follow-up question to that, or if they're like, hey, you know, if you're talking to somebody about their business and then like, okay, what's your goal for the next year? And they tell you, you know, last year I did 5 million, next year I want to do 10 million, right? Then your next logical question is like, so what's your biggest challenge? Like, what are some obstacles that you can foresee that are going to get in the way of you accomplishing this thing that you just said that you wanted to accomplish? And then they'll lay it out for you, right? Talking about my kids, like if you will, social media, access to information, you know, their friends, the people they're going to interact with, their friends' parents, like the conversations, the information, the exposure, the things that I can't control. I can't stick them in a bubble and hide them in the basement. So like my biggest challenge is going to be helping them navigate the complexity of all these relationships and all these things they're going to experience for the next 15 years, how to decipher information. What's my biggest challenge between doubling my business from 5 million to 10 million? Well, you know, it's been mostly like haphazard deals fall in my lap from, I get a referral from over here or over there or a past client, but I don't really have any kind of systematic client acquisition, right? They're going to tell you, like, they're literally going to tell you what they need help with, what their problems are. And then so your next logical question, what's your biggest goal? What's your biggest challenge? How can I help? And y'all, this is a gold mine. These three questions should uncover mountains of information and insight into how you can sincerely help someone have a better life. I don't mean how you can get another customer. I don't mean how you can recruit another agent. I don't mean anything other than how you can help another human. And I didn't used to be this way. I was very much what you call a hunter. There's two types of salespeople, hunters and gatherers, right? Hunters and farmers. Hunters get hungry, they go kill shit, they bring it home, they eat it. Farmers, they plant, water, nurture, grow, harvest. Takes longer, but it's more plentiful. You need to do a little bit of both. At some point, you know, when you start, you got to go kill something, bring it home and eat it, but you should be planting, watering, nurturing other stuff too, right? So this is a nurturing relationship, a value-driven process. And so one of the guys on my team was a former tennis professional. He taught youth tennis for like over 20 years. Really good coach, has some really players that went on to be professionals and all that kind of stuff. He's on my EXP team here in Atlanta. The first time I met him, he walked into a small group from church, a men's group from church, right? I didn't do this to recruit agents. I'm leading a men's group. He comes in, Keller Williams name tag. I like talking to people in EXP because then I can just say what I really think, right? KW name tag, suit. I'm like, hey, when you taught tennis, did you wear that suit? No. Did you wear that name tag? No. Okay. Then why did you put it on? Well, he had never heard people like really talk to him. And so I didn't recruit him like, you need to come to EXP. I was like, let me teach you how to be yourself and actually get clients. Right. It was him. One of the reasons that I was endeared to him is because very early on in our relationship, he brought all of my kids tennis rackets and took each of them at different times to go hit tennis balls. He wasn't a top producer. He didn't deserve my time and attention at that time, but he started finding other ways to add value to the relationship, which made me like him, which then made me spend more time with him, time that ask Carrie, other realtors with other brokerages have to pay a lot of money for. So it pays to invest in relationships, even if it's outside of your core desire to get more real estate customers. Same thing, if you help somebody else with their business, then ideally they think of you when it's time, when someone has a real estate need. And so it's all about digging the well before you're thirsty, investing in these relationships. And the only way that you can do this, invest in a relationship in a strategic way, is to use this process to uncover needs. That's really what it is, like a needs discovery meeting. Now, here's the best part. You've gone through this whole process. At some point they go, shit, like I've been talking the whole time. Like, you're done with your salad because you ask a question and then you eat and they talk. They look down 45 minutes. They got a full bowl. Like, they've been yapping, haven't taken a bite. They're going to be like, I don't know anything. Like, you know, what do you think they're going to ask you? Either all three of these questions, by the way, you should know what your goal is. You know, I helped 20 families buy and sell a home last year. Carrie, you're going to think this is crazy, but like 90% of all clients say that they will use their realtor again. Can you believe that only like 1 or 2 out of 10 actually do?
I know.
Give you a 5-star review, a gift card, a gift, tell you they love you, have an amazing experience, and then they don't reuse you. So my goal this year is to double it. I want to help 40 families. Carrie, is there any reason why if you heard that someone needed to buy or sell a home, would you feel comfortable recommending me?
Absolutely.
You get what I'm like, you've literally at this point, you've just poured into them for an hour, for 30 minutes. They've talked about themselves. You haven't asked anything. You didn't pitch them. You didn't even give them your value proposition. No other realtors listen to them in this way. And then they say, well, what's your goal? And you tell them, or if they don't ask all the other stuff, the one thing they will ask is, how can I help? And how can they help you? Well, if you know anybody looking to buy or sell, if you start the conversation, if you're on the phone, if the first time you meet them, if you're always that person, it's like, hey, do you know anybody looking to buy or sell? Like, you know, everybody says that, but you've just earned the right. Another thing I got from my church, my pastor, the relationship precedes the rules, right? I didn't make rules and then have kids so that I would have someone to follow the rules. I had kids and I want them to be good adults, so I have rules. Same thing in this. Asking for business before there's a relationship, there's no motivation. But if you'll create the relationship first, you can ask for the referral. So relationships precede referrals. And so this is the way that you build relationships. I call them relational deposits. Now, it's probably been a long time since any of you have overdrawn your bank account, although with the current shift in the market, there might be more agents who are overdrawn their bank accounts. But I'm not talking about your physical bank account, but it's a good example. If you go to pull out money and there's none there, it's because you're trying to withdraw more than you've deposited. The deposit comes before the withdrawal. And so you have to make deposits in these relational accounts so that when you do ask for the business, they want to give it to you. This is the reason why you see some people, they come in their first year, they're like, all this business. And then all these other people just like nothing, or they quit. It's because even if a person's new to real estate, their early experience is a reflection on the investments they've made in relationships for the rest of their life and the other things that they were doing. It could be a stay-at-home mom, but she's been heavily involved in her kids, the preschool or the schools or the other activities. She's the classroom mom. She's the neighborhood, you know, president. Like, she's out there investing in relationships. Then she gets a real estate license and boom, she's invested in a lot of relationships. This is just a way to pay it back, right? And so you've probably met that person, your phone rings and you're like, oh God. Because you know the only reason your phone is ringing is because they need something. They don't ever call you and say, hey, Carrie, just for you, here's a gift. They call you and say, here's all my problems. Here's the things that help, right? Are you a giver or a taker? That's all this boils down to. Like, if you're constantly taking, well, then those accounts are going to get overdrawn. But if you're constantly giving, if you're constantly creating value, well, then you're going to be able to withdraw from those accounts. I'm throwing my client event on the 19th. And if you like friends, family, clients, basically anybody that'll come, right? It's the Michael Mayer seven levels of communication. You just throw parties 3 or 4 times a year and invite 1 million people to it. I like events. So we're doing a client event and we're inviting all these people, food, alcohol, music, all this stuff. And one of my partners said, we need some, you know, restaurant small business gift cards from around the area. Let's go buy them, because we're also asking for donations for a local charity for a Toyland program they do, where they provide gifts for low-income families that can otherwise not afford Christmas. So get this, we're throwing a party. I'm going to put a bow on this for real. We're throwing a party. We're going to give food and alcohol and entertainment to a bunch of friends and family and clients. We're going to ask them, because we are loving on them, to then bring gifts or give donations to this charity. By the way, inviting people to the party, most people are going to say no, but I get credit for the invite. The ones that do come, I'm giving them food and booze and all this stuff. I've asked them to do me a favor and contribute to this good cause. They're actually going to give me relational credit for asking them to help this cause. Then I turned around and I called all the people that I networked, all the business owners I know in the area. A cryotherapy business gave me a party pack of 10 for 10 people to come in and do cryo. So I'm going to auction that off for money for this charity. Three or four different friends that own high-end restaurants all gave me $100 gift cards to give to the people that donate to the charity. It is like value across value across value. It's like, how many people can I touch? The coffee shop that I get my $8 lattes at every single day, ask them for a gift card, right? They're also the ones that hired me to be their realtor when they bought a house, then sold it. It was a brother and a sister, and then helped them get houses. Like, this is how this works. It's like every move you make, you should be thinking about how you can leverage that to someone else's benefit. So I beat it to death. But if you want to be able to extract, if you want to ask for referrals, if you want to ask for business, you got to invest first. Here's the hardest part. Sometimes it doesn't come right back from where you put the investment in. Sometimes you make deposits and the payoff comes from somewhere completely different. Like, I'm not sitting here measuring the ROI on a relationship. I just focus on the investment side and I trust that the rest of it works itself out. And I have found that that's way more effective than looking at your list of people that you've invited to the party and be like, well, they come and they eat the food and they drink the drink. They never send me a referral. That doesn't matter. You know what I mean? Just invest in the relationships, because when you give someone something, they feel like they owe you something. You've experienced this. I talked about Jason, the tennis guy who taught my kids. Like, I owed him something. Like, something inside of you doesn't feel right until you settle the score. Unless you're a narcissist, right? Or you're just a taker. But if you're a giver, if someone gives you something, you're just like, oh, now I owe them. Like, even if you don't consciously, you subconsciously, you think about helping this person. And so what you're doing around is you're literally just creating IOUs all around town through this process, whether you're the event host or you're going through this, like meeting people, inviting them, uncovering their needs, helping solve their problems. So, I mean, I have connected more people. The reason that that cryotherapy lady that I just met a week ago gave me a prize pack worth probably, I don't know, $1,000, $1,500, huge, is because when I met her and first experienced that when they opened their store, I was sitting around getting compression therapy in my legs and getting frozen. It was really as cold in there, by the way. And we're talking afterwards. I connected her with three local holistic doctor, chiropractor, wellness centers who I knew their clients would send them to her. I didn't do that. I didn't even think about asking her for anything. In the moment, I'm like, you need to know this person. Like, that's the way I operate. That's the way my head works. You need to know this person and this person and this. Every time I leave an appointment, I'm just thinking of who I can connect people with. I've just been conditioned after 12 years of an event. Like, we don't hope you meet the right person when you walk in the door. We'll get into this when we talk about events. We want to know who you want to know, and we make an introduction. Like, we make it. And if you're sponsoring our event and you gave us $500 for a table for one night, and I know that you're a roofer, the next person that says, I need a roofer, guess what? This could be 3 months later. Boom, I'm sending you this person. So it's facilitating these introductions, it's adding value. And the law of reciprocity says that if you keep investing in these relationships, you're going to get a return on it. And it's always 10 to 1. It's always way more. So I connected this lady with three different people. And then 2 weeks later, I'm asking restaurants for gift cards. And I was like, you know what? She's a block away from this place. We're having a party. I wonder, she's a new business. I have 200 people that are coming to my event that would for sure love to do that. I wonder if I asked her for a gift certificate for one person to do a cryo session. She sent me a party pack for 10. That's the way it works. So I've already beat this to death, so I'm not going to go through it again. But my point is, this is not a direct return you get. It is a journey. And so getting a client might be the destination, but you have to fall in love with the trip. It's the process. Whatever this is a process. I don't care if you call FSBOs, expireds, if you door knock, if you make YouTube videos, if you go to networking events, whatever it is, you have to fall in love with what you're doing. That's why they say, if you love what you do, you'll never work a day in your life. It's because if you enjoy, like, there's 1,000 ways to get fit, 997 of which I hate. So if you ask me, like, I run, I play soccer, I lift weights. If you ask me to swim, I'd be fat because I don't like it. So you got to figure out whether it's this or something else. Like, you got to figure out what's the thing that you love doing that if you do it consistently, it will produce results. This is the farmer mentality. You don't plant a seed and then start screaming at it because there's no fruit. Jim Rohn talks about I forget what verse it is in the Bible, but the reaping and sowing, you know, some seeds fall on rocky ground. Some relationships are just fruitless. Some find fertile soil and start to grow, and the first storm wipes them out. And then others go on to be plentiful crops. And you don't focus on all the rocky ground, all the seed that doesn't work. You just keep planting, keep nurturing, keep sowing, and you will reap more than you sow. And so don't keep score. It's not a transaction. You know what I mean? These are people on the other side of it. And last but not least, I said it earlier. I'm not saying don't ever ask for the business. I do know people that will go out there and they will network and they will meet people and they will give and 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 give. And they don't do three transactions all year long, and they're always broke. And I'm like, but every 5 minutes they're taking their kid, somebody's kids to play tennis, or they're doing someone a favor. Like, they're investing everywhere, but they don't ever just like ask for the business. You should ask. Like, if you don't ask, you don't get. If you don't ask, you don't get. And so give more than you take. But if your seed constantly falls on rocky ground, if it is that person that every time they call, they need something from you, but they don't ever give you anything. Well, they're like, I want to give you my blessing. Move on. Carrie and I, the reason that this relationship works so well is because both of us are trying to outgive the other person. Like, we're not in the same organization. We're not in the same downline. I knew her before she joined EXP. I told her straight up, hey, listen, I know you've got 80,000 agents to choose from. If you would like to discuss a partnership with me, I'm open to that conversation. She joined someone else. I don't care. We're still working together. Like, that is the mindset you should have, but there is so much more value that she has provided to me and my business and my relationship with her. So you need to be in business with people that you know, that you like, you trust, that are like you in the fact that they are value driven, that they are givers. And if you commit to this process, again, it is a process, I can assure you without a shadow of a doubt, you do this for the next 6 weeks going into January, it doesn't matter what the market does. Like, you'll have a better year next year than if you just eat pie and drink cider for the next 6 weeks.
I love that. I agree with everything that you just said. And I'm super grateful to know you. And we're going to do some really cool things together, Jenny and I, no matter what. We always find ways to think at, like, how could we work together? Because I just really respect Denny, and he's done things I haven't been able to do, and vice versa. And that's who you should find to be in business with in any way that you can, is the people who kind of round you out and have strengths in areas you don't, and you, but are in alignment so you can move forward together. So I think that's great. I love this conversation. One thing that you said, Denny, at the very beginning, I wanted to point out, and then I want to open it up for other questions or ahas, is go do life and then get business from it. And I think that's where a lot of people can't figure out, like, I go to soccer games, I go to church, I volunteer here, I go to my bunko with my girls, I do this, I do that. But we don't know how to authentically develop this relationship use our communication skills, follow up, bring value, get people engaged, connect people, and turn it into business. Therefore, we're trying to do all of our personal stuff over here, all of our business stuff over here. Nothing's integrated. We're running out of time. And if we would just figure out how to integrate the two at the highest level in this form of networking, we could be doing more business and having a better quality of life.
Yeah, it's so true. And if anybody's got any questions, I'd be glad to take them. I wish I could say this came naturally or easily. I've had to condition myself to think this way. These guys right here, EPM, they're all across the country. They're fabulous lenders. My loan officer does an amazing job. If any of you want an introduction, let me know. Particularly renovation loans. Also Fannie Mae Homestyle, 203K, VA renovation loans. Vince, the national sales director for the renovation loan, came to ExpCon with me. His office is about 20 yards from me, and they're amazing. But I'm lucky, they're here in Atlanta. This is their national headquarters. Right down the street, they have a suite, a private box at Mercedes-Benz Stadium, Falcons games, Atlanta United games, Taylor Swift concert. I went to Chris Stapleton, Miranda Lambert, and Dwight Yoakam over the weekend.
Wow.
Denny, what's this have to do with anything? That's what this is what has to do with it. I send them a bunch of business and I introduce them to a lot of realtors and they get my business and other business. You know what I do with their box? I go to all the Atlanta United games. I bring my 9-year-old daughter. I invite parents and kids from the soccer team to come to the Atlanta United game and sit in a private box. I took my mother-in-law to that concert that I just told y'all about. I'm using that thing's $400,000 a year. And I'm taking friends and family members to their suite. The tickets are $500 to $5,000 for one ticket. And I'm getting 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them for a game. Mm-hmm. And I'm using my lender's box because I send them a lot of business to love on my soccer team and my church who send me a lot of business.
Yeah.
Like that's how it works.
Mm-hmm. And that you are right. You have to train yourself to think this way. We don't always naturally do that. I think a lot of us are natural in, we want friendships, we want relationships, and you know, we want to help, but there's a strategy and a process behind this too, to learn to be very effective. And it's not inauthentic. It's just honing a skill that you already want to do, but doing it in a way that's actually going to bring value to not only you, but what you heard hopefully Denny say is it brought value to a lot of other people too. It wasn't just about him, but you can bring more value to more people and yourself if you can create a process and train yourself to do it in the right way.
Yeah. The thing you have to learn how to do, and this only comes with trying it, is the identifying what one person needs and what another person needs. By the way, the best introduction in the world is when both parties win. You get credit from both of them.
Yeah.
You know, if I have a realtor who needs a great lender and I have a lender who likes realtors, that's a match made in heaven and both of them like me because of it. So, and that's just a little example, but like you can do that all over. Like I have a client moving from Sweden. They reached out from the YouTube channel. They're moving here. They have a young daughter. She's my daughter's age. Swedish school systems look a lot different than American school systems. American public school systems suck. My kids go to a small private school. Guess what? She was interviewing other realtors. She had met us all online. I didn't sell her on real estate. They were coming to Atlanta. I got her daughter into our private school for a full week. They fell in love with it. Now I get a client. The school gets a student. The parents think I walk on water.
because you're helping. You're thinking outside of the box. I mean, here's the thing. Most of us think like that, but we don't actually execute on it. So we got to get out of our own way to think, I got to sell this person on me being the realtor. That's just our natural inclination. Then we step over very obvious things that we could do to help people. And if we did those obvious things to help them, we'd become the realtor anyway. Right. So again, that's a training of the brain though, because we are conditioned in certain ways. to look for certain opportunities and to sell certain things, especially if we've been in this for a while or if we've been trained in a certain way. So I love this conversation. Okay, two or three really quick ahas or anything like that before we hop off, because I like to end the call that way. Anyone, unmute, please. I see smiles. I know people got some value.
I have a question.
Yes, hi, Diane.
Hi, Carrie, and thank you so much. This topic is right up my alley. You know that, Carrie. So I'm anniversarying a year of being the community connector, growing my relationship with the local businesses, sponsoring the community events, PTA at the school, getting the businesses to sponsor the school, all of the things. So 1 year later, it's naturally what I do love to do, but like you said, with depositing, sometimes I feel like I'm depositing more energy that I have. So my question is about reflection. I know I naturally love to do it. And sometimes I feel like I need a charged. And then, so how do you reflect on your year? And then maybe 5 years, like, is it just like running, working, like training for a marathon? Like you just keep going and you get stronger at it?
So every year, this time of year, I do what's called a stop, start, continue. I literally look at all the things that I'm doing. Carrie and I were like on Clubhouse for a hot minute, right? You know what I mean? Like whatever I do, I just go all in. If you go all in on something for 90 days, 6 months, a year or whatever, you know, like you didn't try it and then quit. Like, you know, kind of what the return's going to be. So I start looking at all of my activities. And then I just simply go, okay, if this is absolutely not working means it drains me. I don't like it. It doesn't work. This is shit. Move on. I stop doing it.
Yeah.
If I go through that process and it gives me life or joy or money or something, if I am happy doing it, I continue to do it. And then I look at meetings like this and I go, what are some ideas I heard at a conference, I heard on a webinar, what are some things that I want to try, and I start doing that new thing. So every year I don't do some like detailed business plan. Carrie probably doesn't want me to say that, she's a better business person than I am. I fly by the seat of my pants. But I do the basics. I'm like, okay, what do I need to stop doing? What do I need to keep doing? And what do I need to start doing? And I just simply go through that little mental exercise with the things that I'm doing on a regular basis. And it doesn't always have to be money. Like if you just love being involved in those things, just do it anyway. And don't worry about the money. It still doesn't mean that you shouldn't ask. You know, I'm very involved in my church. I didn't do it for money and I ended up getting a bunch of clients out of it. Now, it cost me a lot of money in the beginning because when we fell in love with this church, my wife quit her job and went to work for them for half of what she was making. So it cost me a lot on the front end, but you know, there was a reward on the back end. So you can't always measure the ROI, but I would say that if it's draining you, don't do it. If it gives you life, you should keep doing it.
That's great. Thank you.
I think you get joy from doing the events. So don't overthink the results of it, because in that case, it is a time on task over time and you have gotten results. You just can't always directly correlate it to that, but you've dominated in your local market compared to last year. And I know it's because you're showing up consistently and doing those things, and every event gets a different result, but hopefully you learned some good tips. I think Denny's just fantastic at how do you build that rapport and how do you use the most of your time that you have when you're in front of people in those events, which is great. Sarah.
Hello. I was just going to say, I think it's funny when, like, I just got home from the National Association of Realtors convention and you don't like realize how much you utilize some of these things until everything happens like in one big fell swoop. And so I just wanted to, Denny mentioned his link card or whatever. But we went there and I have a digital business card and everyone and their mother was like, oh my gosh, this is the most amazing thing ever. Anyway, I just wanted to let you guys know, if you want one, like I'd be happy to make one for you. And I do 50% off for all of the like realtors in our little group. So I'll just post a little thing here and if it's been really helpful. I saw what Ashley was saying as far as like having a process. The other thing that I love about that is I'm super intentional about the way I use it and getting the other person's information. So like for me, I ask them if I can take a picture with them, and then I put their number in my phone, and then I share my digital business card, but it allows it so that it keeps the ball in your court. And that way you're not just like hoping that, oh, I made this great connection at a networking event. I really hope they call me. You know, it makes it so that you're able to have that follow-up process as well, but then still give them the digital version of it.
Awesome. That's awesome. Great. Everybody grab that out of the chat box if that could be helpful. Sarah is super, super tech savvy, very helpful on marketing, helps a lot of the people in our group if they need that. So use her as a resource. Denny, there you go. Scan Denny's code if you want to.
Scan it. And you'll see, all the links. We have a Facebook group that we do weekly training in, and as a link to our event. Our Facebook group, by the way, Real Estate Connections, is very lively and has a lot of realtors in it and industry professionals. So if you're trying to connect with people in Georgia, that would be a good way to do that. But awesome. If you're not using a digital business card, to Sarah's point, you should be. And if you're not graphically inclined, you should. There you go. Okay.
Yep,
and Denny, I am sorry. I was not trying to step on your toes at all.
You're not at all. I'm not trying to design people's digital business cards.
Same thing. I'm not either. Like I really am. I'm pretty much just paying my designer to do it. This is not like a money making thing for me. So anyway, feel free to go to Denny's link too. I wasn't.
Awesome.
No, you can all go to Sarah's. It's not going to change.
He's like, I do not have a.
I do not have a digital business card to sell digital business cards. It's literally because I can't stand the paper ones.
Yes.
I know. I love it. Yeah, that's awesome. Well, thank you guys all for being here. This is going to be on my YouTube. If you want to pull it out and grab it, watch it again, share it with somebody that wasn't able to attend. It is live streamed in EXP Family Tree. As always, you can watch it there forever. Just go into that group and scroll down the newsfeed and you're going to see us. Thank you guys so much, Denny. You're awesome. As always, you can connect with Denny also on Work Chat. Because he is at EXP, but we're going to bring him back and we're going to talk about how he has monetized Real Estate Connections in Atlanta, one of the top real estate networking events in the whole country. If that is something that is up your alley, stay tuned. Thanks, guys.
Awesome. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.